In a way, I knew this day would come. Not just because I said it would, but because it had to. Everyone has something coming to them. We gain things throughout life. Friends, family, jobs. But we also lose those things as life goes on. Very rarely does it feel like we acquire and lose something at the same time. And yet, here I am. Final Fantasy XIII-3, Lightning Returns. I've acquired this game, and yet, I have lost something. A part of me is gone now. I don't know what part I lost, but I can feel the emptiness. Merry Christmas, everyone.
I'm just a dreamer. I dream my life away.
God damn it. God damn it, Final Fantasy. I can think of no other series that I've given so much money to and received so little in return. But this series is like a heroin addiction. At first, it's great and you feel amazing. You're seeing new worlds. But the more and more you progress, the worse and worse it gets. The more you deconstruct yourself and you feel your mind fall apart, and nothing in life ever feels the same again. Or the games could just be nowhere near as good as they used to be, but, you know, that's not overdramatic enough. But I still love the series, because even most of the bad games have elements of good in them. That was until we got into the 13 series. Final Fantasy 13 is still one of my most hated games of all time. I hate the story, I hate the combat, I hate the leveling, I hate the characters, I hate the world. I hated almost every goddamn thing. It was one of the biggest gaming disappointments I have ever felt. It hurt especially because I went into it with a pure and open mind and even kind of liked it at first because I thought, okay, yeah, this is interesting. I can't wait to see all the other content in the rest of the game. Except there was no rest of the game. The whole thing felt like a 40-hour tutorial with a script written by an idiot. It was one of the only times in a game that I ever considered not finishing it, because it had given me nothing. Nothing but a sense of claustrophobia, because its idea of interesting level design was a narrow hallway, which I guess makes sense because whoever created this game lived in a fucking padded cell. The most excitement I got from it was the end credits, because it meant I was free. I was released from its prison. But, like so many people who finished their prison sentence, a series of bad decisions led me right back to jail, and I found myself once again stuck in this world when I played Final Fantasy XIII-2. XIII-2 was the sequel that absolutely no one asked for. It was a step back in terms of story, but a step forward in terms of gameplay. Every good thing in it was only a half-step improvement over the first game, though. The hallway level design was gone and replaced with sandbox level design, which seems great. The only thing was that they forgot to put shit in the sandbox, so we just ran around jerking off. We also got new characters that were relatively likable, but they were also incredibly stupid. These characters would fall for the old candy in a box trick. We got a more balanced combat system, but it was still the same shitty combat system from the first game. Everything was a mixed bag. Until you got to the story, that is, which was somehow even dumber, more convoluted, and more melodramatic than the first games. It's like you go back to your prison cell, and they fix the toilet, the sink is nicer, and they even painted the walls, but they replaced your cell mat with a bed of fucking nails, and recess has been replaced with theology homework. Every time the game tried to be smart, it became even more fucking stupid. The villain was even worse than the first games. Instead of a deity or a godlike being, we got some feathered emo jackass who wanted to destroy the space-time continuum so he could satisfy his Lolita fetish. It was a mess that had the nerve to end on a cliffhanger guaranteeing that there would be a sequel to that game too. So you'd think if they knew there was going to be a sequel that they would have put all their effort into crafting a game that would address all the complaints that the previous games had. The answer? It's complicated. Lightning Returns is an interesting game for a lot of reasons. It does away with many of the mechanics that the first two games had and adds new features, some of which are actually refreshing and some are just obnoxious. What I find most fascinating is that this game is the most divisive of the Final Fantasy XIII trilogy. Fans of the first two have very mixed thoughts on this game. Now, it's hard for me to take their word for it because they liked the first two games, which I did not. But enough of this preamble nonsense, let's just get right to it. The wait is over, everyone. Let's take a look at Final Fantasy XIII-3, Lightning Returns. So when the game starts, we see I don't really know what we're seeing. A burlesque show in the world of Tron? Wait, is that Snow? Didn't he disappear into nothingness in the last game? And why does he have emo hair now? Wait, what did Lightning just do? Why is everything turning into a DC movie? Why are Snow and Lightning fighting each other? How are they fighting each other? And who the fuck is that chick? Is that Sarah? I thought she died.
Lumina?
Lumina? So I guess it's not Sarah? Wait, where the hell did Snow just go? This intro is terrible. It's not uncommon for Final Fantasy games to throw us in the middle of action right at the beginning, but it doesn't work here in the same way it works in a lot of the other games. In 6, sure, we don't know who these people are, but we are given a title crawl that grounds us in the world and gives us the info we need to understand what's happening. The same goes for 7. Yeah, it starts off as a high-stakes mission, but the mission itself is laid out very simply and is easy to follow, and Barrett explains to Cloud and the player what the objective is in a way that feels organic and natural, given Cloud's position and his character. Even the first 13, to a degree, opened in a way where I could follow the basics of what's happening, but this game and 13-2 start us off with no context and it becomes confusing because we know where we last saw these characters, and seeing them this way contradicts our own memory. What makes it worse is that they are showing relatively important plot points with no explanation, so we have no idea what's even happening. Then in the next scene, when Lightning's narration comes in, the terminology is so overly pretentious that it's easy to zone out. They have terms named after regular words like chaos and savior, but without context, we don't know what these quotation marks mean. And before we can piece together what's happening, we are thrown into combat where we have to memorize other terms like schemata or buona velza. Yes, you can learn all these things later, but to start us off this way just gives the player a headache. We finally get grounded after Lightning leaves Snow behind, though. Basically, after Sarah died at the end of 13-2, Lightning put herself into crystal stasis to preserve her memory of her sister and wait for the end of the world. I didn't know that because apparently I didn't unlock that information when I beat 13-2. In fact, there was a lot of important info at the end of 13-2 that I never got because it was totally optional bonus content. Yet, this game assumes that you knew all that shit already and is continuing off of that, which is why it started off so fucking confusing. But after 5 centuries in Crystal, Buona Velza, the ultimate super god of this universe, wakes Lightning from her stasis. Buona Velza is getting ready to create a new world since humans fucked up the old nice one that he made. He's going to destroy the old world in 13 days and he needs human souls to populate this new world. He gives Lightning the ultimate task of becoming the savior. He wants her to go to what's left of the world and save as many souls as possible in 13 days. In return, he offers to revive her sister, Sarah, so Lightning decides to play along and fulfill her role and save the souls of the living. Now, the setup for this game isn't the worst thing in the world. In fact, it could be interesting, but it leaves questions, like, how can one person be expected to save all the souls of the people in the world, and what does it even mean to save someone's soul? That sounds like a pretty big deal, yet she is expected to do it to hundreds, if not thousands of people in 13 days. That's pretty unrealistic. If God sent her to a trailer park with her goal being to get everyone there to stop smoking meth, I can guarantee that it would take more than 13 days for that shit to go down.
But the big, grand, epic saving souls of everyone in the world?
Oh, that's easy. Would you stop complaining? I think this setup could work if Lightning wasn't the only savior, or if the task wasn't as heavy as saving souls. Maybe if the task was for her to absolve people of their regrets, that would be a lot simpler. But as it is, it wants to tackle something very big on a tiny scale, and it doesn't balance itself out. It's not totally awful, but it's not the greatest setup in terms of story. It could work when it comes to the gameplay, but we'll get into that. So, I know Lightning is on the cover and her name is in the title, but do we actually play as her in this game, or are we getting lied to like in 13-2 where she was barely in it? So, do we get to play as Lightning this time? Oh. Yay, I guess? Like I said last time, I never liked Lightning as a character. In the first game, she was so bland and uninteresting that I never really saw her as a character. I just saw her as a unit that could do a lot of damage in combat, and that's it. And in 13-2, I felt even more disconnected from her because the whole game, she seemed to be having her own confusing story that I never really saw or understood. So to be stuck with her again was not what I wanted at all. But surprisingly, she almost works in this game. Almost. Because of her role as the savior, she has to interact with many different people throughout the world, so we see her in a variety of different social situations, and it allows us to see sides of her character that we never got to see in the last two games. We see her actually learn things from NPCs, and we explore more caring sides of her personality. This was sorely missing from the last two games because she just served as an action figure in those. The great irony here is that she says that she is now an emotionless servant of God, yet I feel more emotion out of her here than I ever did before. It's a huge improvement, but there are some things holding her back. Because she is doing all these good deeds so that she can see her sister again, it does taint a little bit of her motivations. It doesn't really make her selfish, but it makes me question if she would really help all these people if there wasn't something in it for her. Another problem is her voice actress. Allie Hillis is a decent voice actress, but she has a limited range in what she can convey convincingly, and it shows here. When Lightning is supposed to be acting kind, caring, and selfless, I never really buy it, mostly because her line delivery seems so unnatural, which sure you could argue it's supposed to feel that way given her character, but I don't know, it just rings too false. It makes her feel disconnected and cold, which contradicts how her character is portrayed in this game. Don't get me wrong, it works fine for the last two games, and in concept it should work here, but it doesn't because she's not the same cold-hearted bitch she was before. But the game seems to think that she is, it's all over the place. When I'm in the game, part of me actually likes Lightning and some of the character interactions she has, but when I'm progressing the story, then I start to distance myself from her and she becomes less interesting. It's really hard to get a vibe off of her one way or the other. I can say she's improved from the last two games, but I can't say she is a good character now. She's a character lacking a real identity. And here's the fun thing, she's the only character you play as the entire game. Does this series just get off on taking characters away from us? We had 6 characters in the first game, 2 in the second, and fucking 1 here. Can't I play as one of my other characters like, get the fuck it, not him! Yeah, Hope is in this game too, and fuck me for it. Why is he a kid again? Last time we saw him, he was a grown man. Now he's a kid, and there's literally no reason for it. Even the game says there's no reason for it. It's so stupid. It's like the creator said,
hey, you guys remember when Hope was a whiny brat that you totally hated? Here's a visual reminder. Fuck you!
Character-wise, Hope is totally emotionless. Intentionally so. He was kidnapped by Buena Velza and stripped of his humanity so that Buena Velza could use Hope to keep an eye on Lightning. I'm not really sure why God can't just watch Lightning directly though. It feels like a lousy excuse to shove Hope in this game. I can't say much about his character, other than that he is the exposition king. He's basically a walking dictionary full of all the plot and character info that the game was too lazy to work into the story naturally. And he never fucking stops talking.
Say it's likely they don't.
Began a new chapter of its history. Population slowly shrinks.
As if they're images of someone else's life.
I know that I once lived in a great city.
He chimes in every time you start a side quest, every time you come back to the Ark, he never shuts up, and he speaks in the same monotone the whole fucking game. It's so annoying. Every time he talks, it's like I'm being read a bedtime story. He's seriously a datalog disguised as a character. He's just like Fi from Skyward Sword. I'm half expecting Hope to tell me that the batteries in my Wii remote are low. He's just as annoying as he was in the first game for totally different reasons, and a simple rewrite could take him out of the story completely with no changes. I guess their reasoning for keeping him around was so that Lightning wouldn't be totally alone throughout her journey, but if you just gave us an actual party of likable characters, we could avoid that issue. The last character I'll talk about for now is Lumina, the girl who looks like Sarah. And you guys aren't going to believe this, but I actually kind of love her. She is a mischievous trickster who pops in and out of Lightning's adventure, and we're never really sure what she's up to. The game actually does a really good job of making her unpredictable, and I never know how to feel when she shows up. At times, she seems like she's on Lightning's side and is willing to do good things and help people, but at other times, she is joyfully taunting Lightning and— Oh shit, did she just drop a fucking dragon on my ass? Why would you do that, you cute spawn of Satan? I just love what a pure form of chaos she is, and her bubbly personality is so enjoyable and it contradicts her sadistic sense of humor in a way that I find interesting. She slowly plants seeds of doubt in Lightning's mind about Buena Velza's intentions, and we're never really sure who we should trust. This is one of the few things in the game that is done really, really well. Whenever Lumina pops up, I am immediately invested in the story, even if it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. When I have a character I actually care about, Part of me can ignore some of the minor story problems because a good character can distract me from them. It's the same reason why I enjoyed the totally pointless mission with Saz and Vanille in the first game. Yeah, it meant nothing in the grand scheme of things, but it let the characters develop and breathe. Lumina is the shining star of this game. It's so weird. Those are the three most prominent characters in the game. I guess we can exclude Hope since he is just an exposition fountain. Lightning is definitely improved from the previous two games, but not improved enough for me to latch onto her. She's just good enough that I'm at the very least willing to go with her. It's kind of like when your mom drags you through a store when you're a toddler. You don't want to go, but you tolerate the person you're with enough to just do it. And the reason we do it is because we know that once we're done running Mommy Lightning's shitty errands, our best friend Lumina will come over and we can play fun games and tell weird stories. This is like the perfect climax for the 13 series cast of characters. In the first game, we got 6 people. I hated 3 of them, liked 2 of them, and tolerated 1 of them. In the second game, I got 2 characters I tolerated, and in this game, I got 1 character I hated, and 1 character I tolerated, and 1 that I liked. It's all different, yet somehow the exact same thing. If that's not keeping in tradition, then I don't know what is. So the gameplay of Lightning Returns is fairly different than the last two. You play as Lightning, and your job is to go to each section of the world and try to save as many souls as possible. You do this by completing quests. The quests are divided into 3 main categories. There's the main quests, which are tied into the plot of the game. There's 1 main quest in Usnan, Luxarion, and the Dead Dunes, and 2 main quests in the Wildlands. Then there are the side quests, which are the ones that you get when you talk to NPCs with stars over their heads. And the final quests are on the Canvas of Prayers. I'm going to save the main quest for when I go over the story, so let's go over the side quests you get from the NPCs. The difficulty of the quest is determined by their star rating. 1 star is easy, and 3 stars is difficult and time-consuming. Time is a major factor in this game as everything revolves around it. Certain areas can only be accessed at certain times of the day. When the game starts, you only have 7 days on the clock, but by saving souls, you are able to buy yourself more time. The last quests are on something called the Canvas of Prayers. Here you find a list of prayers from the people of the world that you can answer if you have the right items in your inventory. By saving souls, Lightning gains soul energy called Aradia. At the end of each day, Lightning is brought back to the Ark and has to offer the soul she saved to the Tree of Life, Yggdrasil. If she saves enough souls, she can buy herself another day before the end of the world. Yeah, I'm glad most of this game is Lightning gathering soul snacks for her pet tree. So you bounce around the 4 separate areas in the game doing quests before the clock runs out. Some of the side quests are quite interesting and seem to provide Lightning with a new perspective on life, while others are incredibly stupid and hardly qualify as saving someone's soul. The first one is so fucking retarded. You have to help a train attendant find one of his coworkers. You find the coworker only about 10 feet from the guy, and when you reunite them, oh, wouldn't you know it, his soul is saved. You see what I mean when I say the idea of saving everyone's soul is a little much here? Obviously, they needed a couple of easy quests for the players, but when you call it saving souls, it really downplays something that sounds super significant. And look at this. It looks like she's stealing his soul, not saving it. Most of the quests in this game boil down to 1 of 2 things, either fetch quest or kill the monster. Usually, the 3-star ones involve having completed 1 quest to fulfill another or actually developing characters. But more often than not, the characters you talk to are not interesting, so the side quests end up being boring. And there's not as many of them as you'd think. As the game progressed, I had less and less things to do. I beat all of the main quests and did enough side quests to unlock all 13 days, and I've got nothing left. Once you've unlocked all 13 days, you don't really need to do any more side quests since you've bought all the time that you could. I finished pretty much everything by day 10 and found myself just sort of waiting for the end of the game. I didn't complete every quest, but after I've unlocked every day, why would I bother doing time-consuming missions like killing every monster? It just seems pointless. But of course, we don't just have the side quests as a way of buying time. We can also check out the last quest on the Wall of Prayers. To access these quests, you talk to... Oh, really? Chocolina again? I have no idea why she's here. Whatever. I guess I needed some KFC eye candy to get me through this game. Anyway, the Wall of Prayers is the pinnacle of lazy game design. The prayers of random people in the world appear on this with a little preamble to give context as to what the story behind the prayer is. But it all boils down to an unseen person asking for things. Almost everything on the Wall of Prayers is just, have these items. That is it. If you look at the Revenge's sweet quest, it says you have to give this nameless woman 6 niblet hairballs, and that saves her soul. I am fucking serious. Ironically, this one says nameless woman, but they might as well all be nameless since you never see who is putting up these prayers. And how are they even getting these items from Lightning? Did this woman just check her phone? The wall of prayers is just lame. It's like selling your inventory to a shop, except you don't get money. And it really doesn't break my heart that I couldn't answer all the prayers of these nameless, faceless NPCs. These quests are so minuscule that it feels like a lazy attempt to make the game feel like it has more content than it actually does. They could have just added more side quests considering how many NPCs there are in the game, but I don't know how much that would have helped since all of those quests are incredibly simplistic and eventually just become boring anyway. So why do the side quests at all, you may ask? Well, because the side quests are tied to Lightning's stats. I cannot believe I am saying this, but I miss the Crystarium. I miss something that I fucking hated. The Crystarium was an awful way to level up. I hated holding X and watching a screensaver play out as my characters would receive tiny, almost unnoticeable stat boosts. But this method of level progression is somehow even worse. By tying Lightning's stats to side quests, it completely negates the need to engage in combat. You don't get any experience from combat. All the experience you gain is from completing these quests. Every time you complete a quest, your stats increase, but more often than not, the increases are so minuscule that you don't even notice. I never felt like Lightning got any stronger as the game progressed, at least not from combat, which is super disappointing. Watching your stats gradually increase in RPGs helps players better accept some of the unwanted combat that they may find themselves in. Sure, walking through Mount Moon in Pokemon Blue can be a pain with all the trainer battles and wild Pokemon encounters, but by the end of it, your Squirtle has probably evolved into a Wartortle, so it was all worth it in the end. But when levels progress based on side quests, then it just incentivizes the player to avoid combat altogether because it won't make you any stronger anyway. In fact, as the days progress, the game flat out gives you upgrades. I am dead serious. When you go back to the Ark on certain days, the game will give you new abilities. Doing this even further takes away any sense of player progression. I don't feel like I earned anything when you are literally gift wrapping upgrades for me. Look at it! It's a fucking floating Christmas present! Fa-la-la-la-la, lick my sack. Often you'll be gifted special skills for Lightning. These skills are for the most part worthless. The only one that you'll use with any sort of regularity is the Chronostasis ability, which freezes time for about a minute. Most of the other ones are pretty worthless since their function can be achieved by using items instead. The only other ones you'll end up using are some of the combat skills. Speaking of combat, in both 13 and 13.2, the combat system was one of the biggest insults. It was a dumbed-down, player-removed system that reduced combat to mashing X until it was over. So if you guys don't mind, I'm gonna go get a sandwich from the fridge real quick while this fight plays out. Wait, how did I die? I was mashing X the whole time. I should have won. Unless... oh my god! I actually have to do something in combat? Get the fuck out of here! Yes, everyone. After 2 games of autopilot combat, Square Enix realized that maybe, just maybe, people actually wanted to play the games they bought. Weird, right? So we're given a new combat system that seems to borrow heavily from 8 and 10.2. Enemies appear on the map just like in the first 13, and sometimes appear out of nowhere like in 13.2. When you strike an enemy, it initiates the combat sequence. If you hit them without them noticing you, then they start the battle off with 25% less health. If you hit them after they've already noticed you, then they start the battle with 10% less health. And if they hit you first, then you start the battle with 5% less health. When battles start, you can actually control Lightning's position with the analog stick. Lightning's position affects what kind of attacks some of the enemies make, and the enemy's position sometimes allows Lightning to strike multiple foes at once. In the corner are your combat options. And here's where I have to get into the schematas. This is where the game borrows from 10.2, as they are very similar to the dress spheres. Basically, you can switch between different outfits that give Lightning different abilities and stats, so it circumnavigates the need for other party members. Each schemata puts Lightning in a different outfit, and almost all of them come with their own pre-installed actions. And this is where the combat is like the junction system from 8. You assign simple combat actions to each of the 4 face buttons, and you do this for each schemata. So in total, you have 12 abilities. Each schemata has their own ATB gauge that depletes with every action. Some actions consume small parts of your gauge, while others consume massive chunks of it. Once your gauges are completed, they have to be recharged. Your current outfit's gauge will recharge slower than the ones not in use, so you'll often do what you want in one schemata, then switch to another one so you can launch different attacks while the old one is charging. In a way, you're almost always doing something in combat. The game still carries over the stagger meter system too, so there are still enemies that require to be staggered in order for the fight to actually go by at a reasonable pace. Defeating each enemy awards you gold, enemy loot, and AP points, which is basically fuel for Lightning's special abilities like Chronostasis, but some of her abilities play a part in combat as well. The notable ones being Overclock, which slows down time and lets Lightning wail on her opponent a bit more, and Army of One, where Lightning alternates between schematas while dealing damage and healing herself at the same time. There are some other abilities like curing yourself, casting Quake, and removing debuffs, but you can accomplish the same things with items, so I never really bothered using them. When combat ends, unlike the last two games, your health isn't replenished. What? No! What is this? Where are my training wheels? Where's my binky? I thought I was going to be pandered. What is this challenge you speak of? Because your health is not replenished, you have to keep track of your resources. You know, like a game. If your health is depleted during combat, you can either use a Phoenix Down, cast Arise, or run. If you run, however, you lose an hour of time. So there's actually some consequence to battle. This is weird, man. I find it so fucking ironic that the best combat system in any of the 13 games is in the one where combat matters the least. That being said, I have a very love-hate relationship with this combat system. I like being able to physically move Lightning in combat, but why does she have to move at such a snail's pace? Come on! Move! For fuck's sakes, you're in a fight! Run! A minor problem with this combat system is that the default camera angle is all zoomed in and shit, which seems fine, but it's also impossible to fight multiple enemies in this view because you can't see what the other guy is doing. You can zoom out and avoid this problem, but this cinematic angle's attempt to make the fight look cooler actually makes it more cumbersome. But since you can change it, I can't complain too much. I really like that I actually have to do something in combat, but the pace of the combat is still really fast, which should be a good thing, but because you're constantly switching between different attacks and schematas, your attention is constantly being drawn between everything on screen. Oh, okay, gotta pay attention to my gauge. Okay, hit this button. Okay, now switch schematas. Wait, shit, that's the wrong attack. Oh, he's attacking now? Okay, got a guard. What's my health at? Is my gauge filled up yet? Is he staggered yet? Now the other guy's attacking me? Did I just get poisoned? Like Final Fantasy VIII, you assign basic combat actions to your characters. Instead of a list, you assign 4 skills to each of the face buttons. You'll have to get good at this when switching schematas because you'll be mashing the X button to do physical attacks in one class, and when you realize your gauge is low, you'll switch to another schemata and instinctively keep mashing X, but this time your physical attack is on the square button, so you have to either organize each schemata so that each button has a consistent type of attack between them, or just memorize each of the button layouts. But the latter option seems to be impossible because you'll often find yourself setting up new schematas from scratch. I should probably talk about the schematas themselves. They are a lot like the dress spheres from Final Fantasy X too. One big difference is that they are not perverted fan service. Oh.
Oh. Oh no.
Okay. Most of them aren't fan service bullshit. Some of them are kind of cool. Each one of them changes Lightning's stats, but her stats are kind of simplistic. They are essentially divided between health, speed, strength, and magic. It's really basic. Each schemata has their own pre-assigned skills that cannot be unequipped, which can be annoying when you have a stupid outfit that ends up being useful in combat. These schematas are a good way to make Lightning feel relatively versatile in combat, but honestly, I think it would have been better to do away with the schematas. This combat system would have worked better if you had a party of, say, 3 characters, and rather than switching schematas, you switch controls between each character, and these characters would have distinct skills from each other. The paradigm system in 13 and 13.2 was horrible in execution, but not the worst thing in concept. Let's say Lightning would be classified as an average balanced unit. Snow would be a tank, and Hope would be a black mage. You could switch between the different characters so you could do different things in combat, but I'm just going off on what could have been instead of what's here, which I know is unfair, but it's just frustrating because the game came so close to having a great combat system. And this isn't awful, it's just not fully realized. Your schematas can be slightly customized. You can change the colors of them, which is a nice little touch. You can also equip them with 2 accessories for bonus stat buffs, or you can give them an adornment which does absolutely nothing and is purely for cosmetic purposes, which I guess is harmless, but a lot of them look pretty stupid. And thank God they included a tail. I always thought that the lack of furry representation really is what held these games back from realizing their full potential. Didn't you guys learn anything from Final Fantasy IX? Gall. I didn't want to buy any of these worthless things, but there's a side quest where you have to have a lot of them, and it was fucking annoying. Thankfully, they aren't expensive, otherwise I'd be pissed. You can equip a variety of weapons and abilities, which is cool, but a major downside is that none of the schematas can share weapons or skills. Why not? It just seems like a pointless handicap to inconvenience the player. If this was only for the legendary weapons you get later in the game, I wouldn't mind, but throughout most of the game, it just feels like they are forcing you to pick favorites with this setup. There's no reason to restrict skills like this. I will say that another positive of this game is that your more advanced spells actually feel bigger and more badass. But here's what's easily the worst part of the whole combat system. Your abilities are a fucking mess. They seem to have carried over the whole concept of upgrading weapons from the first game, but applied it to your skills this time. It's hard to explain, but here's the rundown. So let's just say you have Fire 1. You'd think upgrading it would make it Fire 2 or Fire-a, but no. When you upgrade it, it becomes a stronger Fire 1. You'll end up having a mishmash of different skills that should be straightforward, but go all over the place. You'll often find yourself having a level 3 Fire 1, a level 1 Fire 2, a level 2 Fire-a, a level 1 Fire-aga, a level 2 Fire 3. It's a fucking nonsense string of words. It should just be either Fire 1, 2, and 3, or Fire, Fire-a, and Fire-aga. If you want to have all of them, then just have them branch off from the original Fire. Why do we need all these sub-levels in different categories? I just don't get it. It's so needlessly convoluted, and it just feels like they had no confidence in how many abilities they gave you, so they just doubled up on a bunch of them and gave them different names. Another downside is that later you unlock these ultimate spells like Flare, but they don't really seem to do that much damage, so they really weren't worth unlocking. Overall, the combat system is a huge improvement over the last two games, but it's not fully realized. It's almost great, but there are too many things holding it back. The biggest one being that combat doesn't get you experience, so it's just better to avoid it half the time. Plus, there's still the overly complicated ability system and the weapon restrictions. I'd say the combat is perfectly fine, but ultimately pointless. And in a game that would be totally boring without the combat, it is a shame that we didn't get a more complete system here. I have almost nothing to say about the soundtrack in this game because I noticed nothing. The majority of the tracks seem to be borrowed from the last two games. I swear, I have fucking NOM flashbacks every time I hear that stupid piano melody from the first game. They play this little melody for you every time you go to the Ark, and it is so fucking lazy. They hired a choir to just phone it in. This is the first time that not a single track in the entire game stood out to me. Everything was so generic and forgettable. I'm kind of dumbfounded. Sure, the first 13 had forgettable music, but the tracks there were made memorable because they were overplayed. Nothing in this game grabs me in any way. Come on, Lightning Returns. Can't you give me one fucking song to latch onto? Wait, is that... Oh my god. Open up the pits, motherfucker! Crazy Chocobo is back! Yeah, I never get tired of death metal chickens! Aside from that, this is easily the most forgettable soundtrack of the entire trilogy. The only memorable songs are songs from the first two games. That's it. So this is gonna get pretty weird. You may have been wondering from the beginning, what exactly is the setting for this game since the end of the last game seemed to imply a lot of bad shit? And to sum it up in a way that makes sense to a human being, Bunavelza is like the ultimate god. He made three sub-gods, Lindsay the Wise, Etro of Death, and Pulse the Wild. Now, Lindsay was the god who created the Falci that made Cocoon, and Pulse built the Falci that came from Pulse, which is basically Earth, which is also referred to as Gaia. The terminology is all over the place. The last god was Etro. Etro was the god of death who maintained the balance between the living and the dead. Etro's job was to keep this shit called chaos energy contained within Valhalla, but at the end of 13-2, things got a little complicated. You see, for some reason, Etro gave her heart to Kaya so he could be immortal and protect Yule, which seems a little extreme. Couldn't the goddess of death just, I don't know, not let Kaius die? Like, every time Kaius' soul shows up to the club, she could just say he's not on the list and send him back to his body? Whatever. So Kaius had Etro's heart, which is the heart of chaos, and when Kaius gets impaled in the heart at the end of 13-2, Etro dies. Because the goddess of death is now dead, boy, that's confusing. But after Etro died, all the chaos energy within Valhalla spread out into the human world, causing the two worlds to become one. By the way, just to go off on a rant real quick, I didn't know this. I don't remember being explained the specifics. I found this out from a book. No, not the datalogs. There was a book. Some of you may be saying, oh, ranting Spider-Man, are you saying that they literally wrote a book to explain the plot holes? No, dear viewer. I'm saying that they wrote TWO BOOKS! TWO FUCKING BOOKS TO EXPLAIN ALL THIS NONSENSE! There's Final Fantasy 13-2 fragments before and fragments after. It literally sums up the story as being so broken that it is fragmented. In fact, between 3 games worth of datalogs, 2 books, 20-hour tutorials, and non-stop exposition from Hope, I've come to the conclusion that this is a fucking book series disguised as a video game. What the shit? When I said Final Fantasy 13 should have come with a book in my first review, I was fucking kidding! Do I really need to keep describing how this world functions? Because I think 2 books prove that it doesn't function at all! But okay, I'll keep going. So like I said, the world of the living and the land of the dead became one. Because of this, they create a new world called Nova Crystallia. Oh my fucking god with these names. Nova Crystallia is a world where people can't die of natural causes, so many of the inhabitants are over 500 years old, but simply don't age. Nova Crystallia is still full of chaos energy that is slowly eating it away little by little. But now it's getting to the point where Buenavelza can't hold it back anymore and opts to just make a new world. At this point, Nova Crystallia has basically been reduced to just 4 regions: Usnan, Luxarion, the Dead Dunes, and the Wildlands. Wait. 4 regions and a game full of side quests where you race against the clock before the end of the world? Holy shit! This game is ripping off The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask, my favorite game of all time! I should cut your fucking dick off, Square Enix, if you think that anything in this game will be as good as that masterpiece! I swear to fucking god, I will burn your company to the ground! Okay, now that I'm calm, I'm going to explain why things that worked in Majora's Mask don't work here. Now, Majora's Mask worked because we were in a small community where the characters interacted with each other. Not just with our main hero, they had daily lives that they led in true schedules. When a character was done with their day in Majora's Mask, we would see them walk to another location. Here, when an NPC's schedule is over, they flat out disappear. Also in Majora's Mask, you could follow your NPCs into buildings. Depending on the place, you would get kicked out at a certain time, often when the store is either closed or the people in the house are going to bed. In Lightning Returns, you can't go into any buildings. There's a disconnect because the people don't feel as lifelike or relatable as they do in Majora's Mask. It also doesn't help that so many of the characters in this game look the same, so no one really stands out in a crowd. Every character in Majora's Mask was visually distinct from each other. Lightning Returns is a game packed with NPCs, but you'd be surprised at just how few of them you can actually talk to. On top of that, the interactions between them are so stilted and awkward. Sure, Majora's Mask could be seen that way, I guess, but that's comparing a 5th gen game to a 7th gen game. It's not entirely the same thing. It should be better here. And when you finished a side quest in Majora's Mask, the characters still had things to do and say. It doesn't matter that you already saved Romani from aliens, you still find her talking to her sister and bonding with her. Sure, you beat the Postman's minigame, but he still plays a part in the Anjouan Cafe quest, because he's tied into the community. Everyone in this game feels so disconnected from each other, and considering that everyone is over 500 years old, how is it that I feel that they have built no bonds in all of that time? Because of the connections we build and how the player integrates themselves in the ins and outs of Termina, we grow to care about the people in that game, so we actually enjoy doing their side quests. It also helps that in Majora's Mask, we can reverse time and let things play out differently, and by doing so, we can see another side of the characters. You can let Romani be taken by aliens and be horrified when she comes back as a lobotomized zombie, constantly grabbing her head in pain. No one wants to see such a sweet character end up that way, so it incentivizes the player to do her quest so that doesn't happen. A big difference is that Majora's Mask was a dark game that wasn't trying to be overly pretentious and overly dark. It presented itself as a standard save the world story. The darker aspects of the game are revealed to the player the more and more they interact with and explore the world. From the beginning, Lightning Returns presents itself as a super important epic, but it creates a huge disconnect with the stilted character animations and the mundane slash weak excuses for soul saving. Some of these quests are intentionally silly, but it contradicts the tone the game is going for. Many of the more comedic bits in Majora's Mask were more character based, but a lot of the time in Lightning Returns, they are situation based. For example, the Dekus flip out and torture this monkey because they are short-tempered comical characters. This kid ends up as a cat because he is stupid. I don't really care about this kid's plight because he is an idiot, but I care about the monkey's plight because he is an innocent character, but his situation is fueled because of the reaction of another character dynamic. Also, many of the characters in Majora's Mask always had things to say and helped flesh out the world and provided players with little hints of side quests and other content. The only NPCs you can talk to are the ones that have their own quest. With how many NPCs there are in this game, why is it that I can't talk to a random person who says maybe something as simple as, "Oh, my cousin got into a fight with some jelly beans. Good thing he knew how to cast thunder magic." Yeah, it's basic, but it can provide the player with insight without having to resort to the data logs again. I think the biggest reason why this game fails where Majora's Mask exceeds is because there is absolutely no sense of dread or tension in the entire fucking game. And no, I'm not operating off of nostalgia goggles. Lightning Returns has no feeling of impending disaster. In Majora's Mask, the first day seems relatively fine on the surface, but the sky serves as a constant reminder of the impending disaster. The twisted face of the moon hangs above you throughout the whole game, and it is always visible no matter where you are in the world. On the second day, the music in Clock Town speeds up a little, and everything seems more hectic. There's a never-ending sense of unease. The rain clouds cover the sky, yet not only is the moon still visible, but it's much closer than it was before. You see characters start to panic and come up with evacuation plans. Then, when the third day comes by, the music speeds up even more to the point where it went from feeling uneasy to feeling like a constant panic. Not only is it sped up, but there are also underlying deep strings that add a harsh, foreboding feeling. The moon is now so close that those eyes feel like they are staring directly into your soul. The sky has gone from being cloudy to looking almost sickly and unnatural. The residents of Clocktown are getting ready to flee. Then, when night comes, just when you think the music will speed up even more into pure chaos, it doesn't. The music suddenly becomes quiet, almost soothing. Characters start to resign themselves to their fate. Cremia wants to inebriate her younger sister so she doesn't feel a thing. Anju and Cafe decide to die together. Muto stands proud, daring the moon to fall, all the while quietly hoping his family escaped, knowing he has already doomed himself because of his own stubbornness. And the once proud swordmaster, who confidently boasted that he could take the moon down with a single cut of his blade, can be found crying in the back of his store, shouting that he doesn't want to die. All the while, the moon just keeps getting closer, and the clock tower slowly counts down to the end. And Lightning Returns, every day is magical! The sun is out, the birds are chirping, business is booming, and nobody cares! Other than the little clock in the corner, there is no sense of impending doom. They could have built up a feeling of dread by having the chaos actually gradually consume parts of the map as the days progressed, but they did absolutely nothing to build up the impending destruction. And it's not like the characters in this game don't know that the world is going to end. Almost every person seems to know that humanity is going to end, but no one seems to give a shit. It makes no sense. Their logic is that people have lived so long that they're willing to accept their fate, which I guess could be interesting for some characters, but not when it's literally everyone on the planet. If the people in the world don't care about their fate, then why the fuck should I? This flat out ruins any tension. If anything, you end up actually looking forward to the clock running out because it just means you're closer to the end of the game. This whole world absolutely fails from a storytelling perspective. However, when it comes to the gameplay perspective, it's actually not that bad. This is easily the best world out of all three games. It's wide and open. It takes an almost open world sandbox approach, which is admirable, but like I said before, the side quests are more so chore, so it's not really all that fun. But it is nice to have big areas. One complaint I have is that Yuzna and Luxarion feel a little too similar. On the one hand, they are culturally distinct from each other. Luxarion is a religious theocracy akin to the Vatican, while Yuzna is more of a party city that prides itself on food. It's not bad, I just wish they were more visually distinct from each other. Even if it was something as simple as having one be more Asian influenced and the other one being more European influenced, or if one was a city and the other one was kind of a big town. But for what it is, it's good enough. The Wildlands is easily my favorite area. It's the closest this game comes to feeling like an open world. This particular area is a beautiful wide open field with small villages, forests, and even a castle. It feels like a mini Hyrule sometimes. Speaking of which, the Dead Dunes feels very much like Gerudo Valley. It's a big desert. It's probably my least favorite area, but I don't think it's that bad. It's probably just because naturally, a desert is one of the last places you'd ever want to be. Stylistically though, I can dig this. The areas are connected through a train system, which is nice. It feels like something an actual functional society would have. Later in the game, you can unlock these roads that connect the area so you don't have to take the train, but I don't see why you'd even bother taking these. They are incredibly long and out of the way to the point where taking the train would be much easier. On top of that, these roads are filled with difficult monsters, and since combat is useless, it just further inhibits your ability to go from point A to point B. I have no idea why they even bothered programming these roads. A minor complaint is that the station to get to the Dead Dunes and the Wildlands in Luxarion is all the way on the other side of town. It's not the worst thing, but it gets annoying walking back and forth. Luckily, unlike the last two games, the shops actually have shit worth getting. There are shops that sell recovery items, ones that let you upgrade your skills, hashtag fuck that, buy new weapons and new schematas. You know, like a Final Fantasy game. You can even go to stores and buy food. It may seem minor, but it adds just a little bit of immersion to the experience. It's not enough to forgive the awful lack of investment from anyone or anything, but it's still a nice little touch. You can also find inns where you can rest up. At first, I didn't see a point in the inns because why would I want to waste time in a game where time is of the essence, but by the last couple of days, I was just sleeping at them all day to get to the end of the game because I had nothing else to do. Yuzna has a battle arena, but the prizes are lackluster and the challenge is underwhelming, so you'll only really fight here when a side quest forces you to. Luxarion has a section of the town that is only open at midnight called the Warren. It's basically a ghetto where poor people and criminals hang out. I just wish at some point Lightning could get some kind of all-access pass, just because sometimes you'll have to wait another day to go in and finish a quest. Again, not that big of a deal. Traversing the Wildlands is actually pretty fun, but I'll get to that later. And to this game's credit, they really prevented exploring the Dead Dunes from becoming a nightmare by offering warping cactar statues all over the place, so it makes traversing this big map way easier. At 6 a.m. every day, Lightning is transported back to the Ark. Now I have to explain what the Ark is. The Ark is the new cocoon that Hope built in 13-2. I guess no one wanted to live there. Anyway, Buñuelos made the Ark a place where time doesn't flow and where Hope can operate as Lightning's oracle. Apparently, God is also a big Apple fan because this looks like a tomb designed for Steve Jobs. In the Ark, you can spend EP points to buy things from Hope, which are useless because EP is way more valuable than Gil, and you can buy items that provide the same effect for relatively cheap. It also has a little book where you can refight old bosses, and it is 100% pointless. They bring back the star system just for these boss battles, and in true Final Fantasy XIII tradition, the stars don't mean shit. You would think that getting a 5-star ranking would offer more rewards. Nope. According to Square Enix, your reward is a nice warm fuzzy feeling inside. Christ, did EA have a hand in this? This is also where you are just given upgrades. Not because you earned them, but because the game is almost over. Again, I hate this. Square Enix decided to offer no rewards for beating boss battles with higher stars, but will still reward you with new abilities for letting the clock run out. That makes sense. Story-wise, I don't mind the Ark, it serves its function fine, but my major gripe with it is being warped back to the Ark at 6 a.m. every goddamn day. Could you imagine playing Majora's Mask, being in the middle of a dungeon, but on dawn of the second day, you get warped right back to the fucking clock tower? And there is no reason for this. They throw out that it's for the space-time distort or whatever, but it comes across as them just stringing together a bunch of words to cover their asses. I don't know if it's a technical reason or what, but it's really stupid because it makes you race against the clock in a bad way. I don't mind racing against the clock before the end of the world, but not when I'm in the middle of a quest. You could be in the middle of a time-restrictive quest and then you just get dragged back to the Apple Store to hang out with Captain Boomerang and his Chia Soul Tree. Fuck you. Getting into a more technical aspect though, in case you guys couldn't tell, this game has had a noticeable graphics downgrade from the last two. This is really evident in the beginning when you see Yusnan. This looks like something out of the Final Fantasy X remaster. I don't really mind bad graphics, but it does make this game feel rushed, which is weird because they knew they were making this sequel. The worst part is the frame rate. Sometimes I could get a nice 60 FPS, other times it was really bad. Oh fuck me sideways, these frames are so good! And it's not my PC. My PC is very competent. I even compared this to the PS3 version, which looks almost exactly the same. I had the game running at max settings, and I still got this ugly aliasing in both versions. It's just poorly optimized on either platform. A nice thing I can say about the PS3 version is that you can install the game directly into your hard drive like an Xbox 360 game, which definitely helps the load times, but the game still lags and looks dated. I'm torn on this. In many ways, this is what I wanted from the beginning. I wanted an open world. I wanted side quests. I wanted shops where I could actually buy things. From a gameplay perspective, the world is perfectly serviceable. It needs more side quests both in terms of quality and quantity, but it's still good enough in a lot of ways. Yet it's a world I feel no attachment to. I don't care about the people in it because I can't talk to most of them. It never feels like I'm in a real community. It always feels like I'm in a HUD. This is a world that is fine on the surface, but offers nothing past that. At long last, dear viewer, we come to the story. I will go over everything in detail and point out whatever doesn't make sense to me. Just to remind you guys, Lightning returns to the Ark after her attack on Snow that I still don't get. Hope points out all the major chaos distortions that Lightning needs to fix, and those serve as our main quest. It should be noted that this game goes for a non-linear structure. You can focus on any part of the game at any time. Therefore, I'm just going to go over them in the order I did them. So let's figure out this whole Snow situation in Yusnan. So Snow has become the ruler of Yusnan because I guess they really dug his trench coat collection. And he has fallen into a dark despair, constantly living in regret over his lost love. It sounds sweet, I guess, but what the fuck is so special about this girl? We saw very little interactions between Snow and Sarah in the last two games. And seriously, dude, you couldn't get over your dead girlfriend after 500 fucking years? Really? I mean, yeah, I was sad when my wife accidentally fell on the knife that I was stabbing her with and died, but you know, a good couple of days of ice cream, Friends reruns, and a hacksaw really helped me get over it. Anyway, after Lightning's last attack, the palace is under tight guard, so she creates a fireworks show that probably ends up killing hundreds and is able to distract the guards long enough to infiltrate Snow's palace. Snow is still Alicia, I guess, and is using his powers to absorb the chaos energy that's slowly consuming the palace. What the fuck is the point of that if the world is going to be consumed by chaos anyway? Lightning finds him locked in his room with ice. Get it?
Do you wanna build a snowman?
Snow plans to enter some big concentration of chaos energy that's in the palace. Snow also tells Lightning that his first attack on her was to make sure that she was the real Lightning and not some fake Lightning. And that's a plot line that goes absolutely nowhere. Snow is so guilty over his inability to protect Sarah that he plans to absorb the chaos energy, transform into a Seath, and have Lightning kill him. Why he just doesn't shoot himself in the head and get it over with, I couldn't tell ya. So he turns into a Seath and you have a pretty simple boss battle. When you defeat him, Lumina pops in to taunt you, and I just love what a nasty little trickster she is. So Lightning goes up to Snow and this is where I get conflicted, because what follows is actually a really well done character scene where Lightning pleads with Snow to remember his true self so Sarah has someone to return to when she comes back, and it is genuinely one of the only times I felt real emotion in the whole trilogy. It's one of the first times you see Lightning in a position of powerlessness. She shows emotion here and actually begs, selflessly I might add. It shows us a side of her that we've never seen before. The downside is that the resolution is stupid. Snow is basically saved via the power of love. It's not entirely clear. I think she saved his soul and that turned him back to normal. I guess it would make sense seeing that her power could probably overrule the power of the Foul Sea Curse, but a little more exposition would have helped here. But when Snow is back to his old self, we get some more great character interactions, and that is a sentence I am not used to saying given this trilogy's history. Snow decides to keep Yusnan safe for the end of the world. I wish he would have joined my party, but whatever. We're done in Yusnan, and the conclusion was actually satisfying. So now that we're done here, on to Luxarion. So in Luxarion, women with pink hair are being murdered by a cult known as the Children of Etro. They are a bunch of fanatics who worship the goddess of death and think that if they kill the savior, they can prevent the destruction of the world. Lightning begins investigating where the cult is operating. During her investigation, she hears of a vigilante known as the Shadow Hunter. She soon learns his identity when she is attacked by him, and it's revealed that he is none other than Noel. See, Noel was given a crystal ball that has a fake prophecy of Lightning destroying the world, and Noel believes that if he kills Lightning, that he can save the world and be reunited with Yule. For fuck's sakes, really? Wasn't Noel like one of the few intelligent people in the last game? Now he's an emo idiot who will believe whatever this little cotton candy hellspawn tells him. And what is so fucking great about Yule? All she did in the last game was speak nonsense and die, over and over again. We only ever saw one scene of Yule and Noel together, but it was an illusion anyway. So why the fuck would anyone want to save her? I wouldn't want this little bitch. She'd probably creep me the fuck out. I'd just be at my breakfast table eating cornflakes and she'd be at the other end of it staring at me all creepy and shit. No thanks. Anyway, Lightning and Noel briefly team up to save a woman from the Children of Etro, and they quickly defeat all the members of it. Later, Noel and Lightning have a fight where Noel manages to get the upper hand and just randomly decides to not kill Lightning because it's not what Yule would have wanted. Bro, you couldn't have figured this shit out beforehand? And I guess that this somehow saves his soul too? This was fucking weak. We're not quite done in Luxarion yet because we head to the big cathedral to meet with the Order Saint, and we find out that she is no, 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 no! Can't I ever get away from this Lolita jailbait? Oh, and she's the saint. Well, I guess this game is accurate to real life because just like the real church, this one is fucking stupid and evidently full of creeps. So yeah, Vanille is here. After her and Fang woke up from their crystal stasis, Vanille learned that she could hear the voices of the dead. They got picked up by the church, who takes an interest in Vanille's new abilities. They essentially decided to keep her confined within the cathedral. Vanille shows Lightning a place where the souls of the dead have gathered. She is preparing to do some ritual on the final day that will apparently purify the souls of the dead, but it will also kill her. She wants to do this to make up for her past, but I don't get that logic at all. You held up an entire civilization for 1,000 years. I'd say you're forgiven. Honestly, Vanille, your biggest crime is just existing. And boy, do I have a solution for you. Fang evidently ran off to the dead dunes to get some relic called the Clavis that Vanille needs for her ritual. You can't really do anything with Vanille until the ending, so we're done in Luxarion for now. But Fang is such a forgettable character that I'm not even going to bother going to her just yet. Instead, let's head on over to the Wildlands. So in the Wildlands, Lightning wants to go to the ruins of Etro's temple because there's a lot of chaos energy coming from there, but she can't do this on foot. She hears rumors of a white chocobo with special abilities that the locals call the Angel of Valhalla. You eventually find the chocobo injured, nurse it back to health, and you can ride it throughout the Wildlands. I wish the chocobo went a little faster though. It runs about as fast as Lightning does when she's sprinting, and the chocobo itself can't sprint. Along the way to the temple, you run into Mog, who now lives in a Moogle village, and that is so classic Final Fantasy, I kind of love it. Mog doesn't bother me as much in this game just because the tone of this game is not as overly serious as the last one. And honestly, the tone of these games is all over the place, so why care now? You also run into Saz, and not in any special way, he's just kind of walking around. Saz has fallen into a deep depression because his son Daj is now in a coma and his soul has been fragmented. Saz has been spending the last 500 years looking for it. See, this setup works a lot better than Snow's, but the presentation of the situation is so much worse. Part of me does love that Saz honestly does not give a fuck about seeing Lightning again for the first time in 500 years. You are able to find the pieces of Daj's soul pretty easily, I might add, so Saz is just dumb. And interestingly, this is a part of the game where Lumina helps you. She actually gives Saz this little box that is able to hold the fragments of Daj's soul. But when the soul is returned to the body, Dodge doesn't want to wake up because Saz's face has become scary due to 500 years of stress. Okay, listen here, you little shit. If you don't get up right now, I'm getting the belt!
Dad, that's not fair.
Yeah, that's what I thought, bitch.
The Chocobo chick plays a part in waking up Dodge, and this is where shit gets really fucking weird, guys. So, apparently, this whole time, the Chocobo chick has actually been... Chocolina. I am dead fucking serious, and it is glossed over! They just throw it out there like it's common knowledge. Has it gotten that bad now, people? Do I have to bring tuna to dinner just to make sure that my date isn't secretly a fucking cat? In fact, Chocolina is technically a chick, so...
Whatever, I'd fuck her to crazy Chocobo anyway.
I want to fuck Chocolina in her Choco Nest. Got it.
I guess I needed some KFC eye candy to get me through this game. Did Final Fantasy just try to make me a pedophile? What, I didn't fall for the Lolita jailbait, so you decided to throw some feather trap at me? Kiss my ass, game. I'm never answering the wall of prayers again. I'm keeping my distance from you. You won't get me with your-
No! No! We are moving on!
Also, we learned that the Chocobo Lightning has been riding this whole time is actually her eidolon, Odin. Why do Chocobos have more secret identities in this game than Arya Stark? Is anyone else a giant chicken?
What the hell are you?
And did Lightning and Odin have some deep friendship I was never told about? He was literally just a vehicle in the first game, but now they're besties. Whatever. So Lightning heads over to the Temple of Etra to find what's causing all the chaos disruptions, and she runs into Caius and Yule. Just seeing these two again makes me realize how much I don't care about them. At all. So evidently, Caius has still been listening to his Simple Plan records and just wants to die now, but he can't because all the Yules want him to live. I really don't get it. So you have a boss battle with him, and he refuses to let Lightning take his soul, and... that's it. This whole thing was a waste of time. Well, almost. You do get his sweet Duskmon sword, so I guess that's something. And he decides to just hang out in this temple, I guess. What does he even do here?
I hate my job, I hate my life, I hate every fucking thing in this world.
So yeah, this was kind of an underwhelming conclusion here. Then again, Caius is easily the most uninteresting villain out of this entire trilogy, so what did I expect? I guess we're off to the final region now. It's time for the Dead Dunes. So Lightning works her way into some thieves' hideout and finds out that their leader is actually Fang. The two of them use Lightning's savior powers to unlock the doors in the ancient ruins and begin looking for the Clavis. And this part of the game sucks. It's so time-consuming and boring. You're just walking around a fucking maze. The doors are on a time grid, so everything shifts around every hour. And since this game is a race against the clock, you're constantly trying to make progression before you get warped back to the Ark. I hate this place. After you eventually find the Clavis, Fang actually plans to destroy it to stop the Order's plan and save Vanille. Lightning tries to stop Fang, but the Order comes in and drops a monster in your lap. Once you beat the monster, the Clavis is gone. Fang decides she's going to break into the church on the last day and take the Clavis during the ritual. I can't believe I'm on the church's side here, but let Vanille die. So, we're pretty much done here. We didn't save any souls, but apparently we're done. I should note that almost every time you get closer to the end of the game, you encounter Lumina in Lightning's mind, a place where Buonavelza can't see. Throughout Lightning's journey, Lumina is slowly planting seeds of doubt in Lightning's mind about Buonavelza's true intentions and if he really can bring Sarah back. Lumina also hints that a part of Lightning's soul is missing, but won't tell her which part. On other days, when Lightning returns to the Ark, she is visited by Sarah, who keeps reminding her of how close they are to being together again, but Lightning feels nothing towards her. This is another element of the game's story that is done relatively well. All these ideas sit in the back of Lightning's mind and she starts to wonder who she can trust. She doesn't even know she can trust Hope anymore since he is Buonavelza's eyes. It's really interesting. But it gets really weird when we get a visit from Cid Reigns. Yeah, remember this dumbass? Cid is actually a messenger for the souls of the dead, asking for help. Buonavelza can't actually see the souls of the dead and views them as impurities that need to be destroyed. Lightning cannot save their souls, as that power only belongs to Vanille. But the little ritual Vanille is going to do is actually going to destroy the souls of the dead and prevent them from being reborn in the new world. So Buonavelza wouldn't really be able to bring Sarah back. he would just end up making a copy of her, and Sarah's true soul would be destroyed by Vanille. After all of this is revealed to her, Lightning decides to betray Buenavelza and stop Vanille's ritual. So on the final day, Lightning heads over to Luxarion, where she runs into Lumina. Lumina tells her that the Soul Song will erase everyone's memories of the dead, and without people remembering them, it will be as if they never existed. So Lightning breaks into the church and stops the ritual. She is soon joined by Fang, and she's also joined by Snow, who is able to destroy the Clavis. Vanille learns the truth of what the dead want and manages to guide their souls to the Ark so they can be reborn in the new world. It sounds like this is the perfect solution and that Lightning has saved everybody, but not quite. Suddenly Hope appears, and it's revealed that Hope is God. I'll be right back. Okay. So basically, Buenavelza took over Hope's body centuries ago so that he could understand how people work so he could purge their souls better. Why he took over some kid in an Ark totally disconnected from humanity instead of, like, literally anyone else, I don't know. He steals the souls of Snow, Fang, and Vanille and gets ready to make his new world. Lightning follows him, guided by Mog, who's here for no reason at all, and she finds Buenavelza in some place beyond time and space. Apparently, Buenavelza is so impressed with Lightning that he decides that he wants her to take Etra's place as the goddess of death. Lightning, naturally, doesn't feel like hanging out with some dude who overcompensates for his tiny dick with four pairs of wings for all of eternity. And there's only one golden god for me, pal. So you have an epic final boss battle against Buenavelza, and to his credit, unlike Caius, he actually puts up a fight. Once Lightning beats him, she's able to free the souls of all of those Buenavelza has captured. She decides to plunge both God and herself into the chaos for all of eternity. In the chaos, Lightning sees the Sarah clone that Buenavelza made, who reveals that Buenavelza didn't cut away part of Lightning's soul, Lightning did it to herself. It's revealed that this whole time, Lumina was the physical embodiment of all of Lightning's insecurities that she purged from herself when her parents died, which is a really interesting idea and well executed, but it just feels like they are trying to justify what an unlikable bitch Lightning was in the first game by retconning her background here. If this was just Lightning accepting her faulty human side of her soul that Buenavelza took out, I think that would have worked better. So Lightning accepts Lumina back into her soul and finally decides to once and for all become a three-dimensional character. She also decides not to stay behind in the chaos and continues to fight Buenavelza. One of my problems with Buenavelza is that he just feels like an evil bad guy, and that's it. He doesn't feel like a god. Fire Emblem Radiant Dawn has a plotline where we had to defeat God, but that god wasn't evil. She was just cold, uncaring, and totally neutral. She operated based on just pure logic. Buenavelza is just a mustache-twirling villain with a megaphone and a thesaurus. He even has an evil villain laugh. It really disconnects any illusion of a loving, caring god. So Lightning battles Buenavelza and is joined by Hope, Noel, Snow, Vanille, Fang, and all of their Eidolons. And I'm not sure how they have Eidolons if they aren't still a sea. Anyway, after a big blast, they manage to defeat God again. The gang relishes in their victory and they are joined by Saz, Dodge, and the Choco Trap. But there's one more person who wants to see everyone.
Hey! You gonna join us?
Yep.
Yes, at long last, Sarah is back, but Buenavelza is still not done. You know, for a god, you sure do get your ass kicked a lot. But Lightning makes a soul sword out of all of her friends and destroys God once and for all. Thanks for the new world, asshole! After Buenavelza dies, the gang runs into...
Oh my god, I don't care about either of you!
Caius lets everyone know that the world of the dead still needs a god to guide them, so Caius and all of the Yules decide to stay behind in the world of the dead. Fucking Christ! Yules are so disposable. In fact, this whole December, I was using a bunch of Yules to keep my fire going. Sure does keep up the Yule time cheer. Fa la 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 la, let's burn, kids. Anyway, Noel is all sad that Yule's not coming to the new world, but then Caius kind of just sends Noel away with his own Yule. God damn, this bitch is like a Pokemon, gotta catch them all! So everyone prepares to go to the new world and they say goodbye to all of their Eidolons. And Mog for some reason. Okay? They give us this stupid ass clip show of the last two games as if they're rubbing salt in our wounds. And they all disappear into the new world in a way that looks like, once again, they're trying to remind us of Final Fantasy VII. Fuck you! After the credits, we see Lightning get off a train in the new world that... Wait. Is this the world of Final Fantasy 15? Is this fucking game a prequel? What, are they trying to connect this shit like they tried connecting 10 and 7? Lightning gives a creepy smile, and the game finally ends. This is... complicated. There are so many good ideas in this story, but they aren't presented in a natural or organic way. All of it feels like they wrote a bunch of explanations to make up for the plot holes in the last games. The explanations aren't that bad, but I don't believe for a second that all of this shit was planned out in advance. And really, this game downplays 13-2 to such a degree that it makes that entire game feel pointless. It didn't really matter. The only thing that game set up that was necessary here was Etro's death, but they probably could have found a way to work that into the first game. Everything that holds Final Fantasy 13-3 back is the fact that it's based off of two shitty games. It's the ultimate handicap because they were so nonsensical that you had to pay attention and memorize every little piece of dialogue in those games to get a grasp on what's happening in this one. So where does this game fall? Honestly, to my surprise, this is the best of the 13 trilogy. Lightning is relatively likable here compared to the last time we saw her, and the gameplay is significantly improved to the point where it feels almost nothing like the first game. This game also gave us Lumina, who is genuinely a fun and interesting character who brings a sense of bubbly chaos that we haven't seen in a while. But the story could never stand on its own, the progression system is terrible, the music is totally forgettable, and it's just not packed with enough content to make me want to stay in this world. The final score for Lightning Returns is a 6 out of 10. It's way better than the last two games, but it's not that great out of context. But it's still easily the best of the worst. In terms of story, the worst one, without a fucking doubt, is 13-2. Nothing in that game makes sense, the villain is pretentious and forgettable, and the whole adventure ultimately meant nothing. But the worst game of the three is still the original 13. The story in that is almost as bad as 13-2, most of our heroes are totally unlikable, and the gameplay is absolutely atrocious. I just feel so conflicted. I wanted this to be a grand finale of me ranting and raving, but I can't with Lightning Returns. It's just not that bad of a game. I don't know what to do. Maybe I should just give up. I've wasted my entire Christmas. Yeah. I give up. You win, Final Fantasy. You broke me. Oh, what the hell is that? Santa? Wow, you... really didn't live up to expectations.
Wahaha!
Don't you mean ho ho ho?
No! Anyway, I've come to give you a gift!
I thought you already did! You gave me this stupid game!
That was a test! Now I've come to give you a real present!
Well, what are my real gifts?
Check your box!
What box? Oh.
Some kind of sick joke, motherfucker?
No! You forgot to check your other box!
What other box?
This better be worth it, asshole. You want me to... oh, I'm gonna love this.
It's time for you to complete your focus.